Everyone, it's me, Nikki, and today I'm here with my February wrap up. Don't know what to... Everything is a mess in my house right now. My grandpa had to have his big toe removed because it was really bad. I don't want to like be too explicit because it's kind of gross. So my mom has been dealing with all of that shit show from like the hospital. They have been so bad with him. Like he needs physical therapy because he's got a toe removed, so he can't walk or stand. Like his balance is weird. And he's like 91, so his balance is off anyway. So yeah, it's just been like a shit show. We basically have done nothing. The house is a mess. We're like, haven't gone to the grocery store, nothing. But we don't care. I was able to read through all of that, and that made everything a little better. So I'm gonna just start with To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee. Let me see what I did this. What did I give this on my call pile? If it ever loads. Anyway, probably a lot of people know what this is about. It was made into a really famous movie with Gregory Peck. And so this is written by Harper Lee in the 60s, but it's set in the South in the 30s, I think. I know the Depression's on, but I don't know where in the 30s it sits. And I gave this. Four stars. There is the use of the N-word in this. The white people say it in the bad way, but also our main character, Scout, says it, but she is like six to nine, I think. So she didn't actually know what it means. She just heard it at school and repeated it, and her dad was like, "We don't say that word." And so she doesn't say it again. So anyway, this is about Scout and her brother Jem, but it's from Scout's perspective. Set in the South, Alabama, I believe. Or no, the author's from Alabama. I don't even know if it says. It might say, but anyway, it's in the South. And their father, Atticus, is a lawyer. And so I think what everybody knows is there's two famous sort of obviously stories. There's the kids trying to, I don't know if they want to befriend, but there's a neighbor who lives near them. His name is Arthur Radley. They call him Boo because he doesn't come out. Was he in a war? He might have been in World War I because he's got a brother. I'm not a hun I can't remember, but he basically came home one day and he doesn't leave. And they try to like knock on his door and come out, but he doesn't. And the Atticus tells them to knock it off. And then the other part of it is Atticus defends a black man accused of rape. Unfortunately, it doesn't go well, and that's why the N-word is thrown around at Scout because they say her dad is a blank lover, and Scout doesn't know what that means. And she goes, D "Atticus, you're not a blank lover." And he goes, "Whoa, whoa, 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 whoa." So. And Atticus tries to keep, especially because Jem, Scout's like 6 or 9, like I said. So Jem might be 9 to 12, maybe. I don't know how much older he is, but he is older. But Atticus tries to keep them both away from that, type of racism because he doesn't raise them like that. He's pretty liberal, for living in this town. I really enjoyed it. Well, there's a whole part in the beginning that is not in the movie where Scout has to go to school for the first time. And I didn't really care for that part, but it's just sort of setting up the town and you meet a lot of people. And the young woman who is supposedly raped, her brother, you meet him. So it's sort of setting up like that. So yeah, I thought it was really good. Just, you have to be aware it is written by a white woman from the South in the 60s and set in the South in the 30s. So there is obviously racism, but never from our main characters intentionally because she's just a little kid. What else was I going to say? The movie's really good. I would suggest reading the movie. Reading the movie? Watching the movie. And then there is a quote-unquote sequel, but it is actually a original draft of this. So I wouldn't bother with that. You can look it up online, but this is superior. And I think everybody should read it. And it's really good. And it had Robert Duvall in the movie. That was like one of his first roles, I think. Like a baby Robert Duvall. Okay. Next is, and I think it's important to read, especially now, because things haven't really changed, but it is a good book, and I definitely recommend it. Next is Blood Moon, An Epic War of Splendor in the Cherokee Nation by John Sedgwick. I didn't star this. I think I have starred other nonfictions. Well, this one's hard for me to star. I would probably give it 4 stars as well. This is about two. Well, it's about the Cherokee Nation, but it is specifically about the Ridge and John Ross. They are both mixed Cherokee. There's pictures in here. That's one of my favorite things about nonfiction books, is the pictures. The Ridge is more brown. That is the Ridge right there, and that on the other side is John Ross. So he's got more Cherokee than John Ross because he was 7/8 Scottish. And Major Ridge, as he gets titled, he. Okay, this is complicated. So it's a bit of a slow start because the author has to explain the Cherokee in general, right? Like where they were, all their beliefs, that kind of stuff. And everybody knows what happened to them and the other five quote-unquote civilized tribes in the area. They were forcibly removed from their native lands because of settlers and gold. Because Andrew Jackson hated all Native Americans. They all did, basically. And before that, they said they were told by the government, not just the Cherokee, but I think all the tribes, but the Cherokee were told, you can stay as long as you are not Cherokee. You have to become American citizens. And so the Ridge, because they talk about his life as a young man and John Ross's, but the Ridge is kind of into that. And he, as you saw, he dressed up like a white man. Well, they all did, but you know what I mean. And he had a plantation and slaves, and he sent his kids to, like, there were schools where they could learn to read and write English, but also, like, learn Christianity. Because there were a lot of those missionaries coming in trying to convert them. And so The Ringe had a lot of mixed bloods, as they say in the book, under his sway. And Ross, he was more white and he had a lot of the full bloods under his sway. So that seems interesting. That's interesting to me. And eventually they came to loggerheads because the Ridge and his faction was like, we should leave. They're going to give us all this money for the land and we can just go west and figure it out. But Ross and his people, well, Ross specifically said no. You know, there was a lot of fighting in between the two groups. But eventually they left and they had to. And it just didn't get any better when they went into what is now Oklahoma. And they continued fighting there because, now this is interesting, I didn't know this. Before the forcible removal, they told Cherokee to leave. So some already had gone there. So they're called the Old Settlers, which is also a recognized tribe. I can't remember what it's called at the moment. So there's three tribes, the Old Settlers tribe, the Cherokee, and then the Eastern Band, which didn't. They just went and hid in the woods and fucked off. So there was tension between the Old Settlers, the Ridge, and then the Ross group. And then the Civil War happened. And again, surprising to me, a lot of the tribes went with the South. Because the South said, oh, we'll give you money. I can't remember what it was. It wasn't like you could get because that's all in the South now. So, and that was interesting to me because it starts with the Civil War, Revolutionary War. And it's interesting because whichever war the Americans were fighting, the natives were always on the other side, which logically makes sense. But historically, it never worked out for them. They chose the British in the Revolutionary War, they chose the French twice, maybe, and then they chose the South. So, yeah. But I understood why they did it. And then, another thing that happened is the Ridge, his son, and a nephew were all murdered. And by a group of Ross men. This was before the Civil War, and it did not help things, because John Ross has always been sort of shady. A lot of tribal chiefs, not just Cherokee, but other tribes, did take bribes in either money or whatever they were given. So people thought Ross took bribes, whether he did or not, nobody knows. But it always felt very suspicious to people. So when the Ridge and his family, two of his family members were killed, everybody assumed Ross was behind it. And when I read it in the book, it seemed a very Henry II situation, because you know, Henry II allegedly said, "Will no one rid me of this meddlesome priest," out loud to a group of knights, and then they went off and killed Thomas a Becket. And Henry says, "Oh, I didn't mean it like that. I was just venting." And the knights took it upon themselves. But other people are like, he probably literally said, "Can you get rid of him for me?" So whether Ross knew or not is up for debate. But yeah, you know, it just didn't end well for either faction or the Cherokee Nation. I mean, so many of them died, not just on the Trail of Tears, but with the infighting between the two factions and then during the Civil War. Just so many of them died, and so many of tribal members died, you know, not just from fighting, but like diseases and smallpox, I think specifically, starvation. They, 'cause, you know, Oklahoma, Indian Territory, Oklahoma's over here, and Washington's like all the way over here. And they're like, do they really need that money? I mean, can we just like wait another month? So, but yeah, I like this book. I learned a lot about the Cherokee Nation. I learned a lot about these two men. My supposed ancestor, Pathkiller, is mentioned in this book. Not a lot, but he is mentioned, so that was cool. I say supposed because we're not 100% sure. A family tree says so online, but we have no DNA to prove it. I think I've talked about that before. And you also learn about some white people that stayed with the Cherokee. It's a priest and a school teacher who were trying to make them American, whatever that means. So yeah, I liked it a lot. And I am, yeah, it's good. I would like to read more books about native tribes, not just the Cherokee. Next is Girls of Storm and Shadow. This is book two in The Girls of Paper and Fire. And I gave this 5 stars. And my note was it went all went wrong in the end because this book is 400 pages and probably about half of the book, which was fine for me, is them traveling from place to place to gain supporters after what happened at the end of the first book. And then, like the second half, maybe even the last 100, 150 pages, everything goes wrong. Everything goes wrong. One of their companions dies, another one leaves, there's betrayal, there is, like I said, murder. The girls are separated. They have an argument. They have a lot of arguments actually in the last 200 pages because Ren hasn't told Lei everything about herself, her father, what they're trying to do, and it's just like a total shit show at the end. Everything goes wrong. I don't know how it's all gonna get fixed in the third one, but I can't wait to find out. I loved all the characters. And then, like, it hit the right beats of, like, when you find out stuff, you're like, oh, no, I don't like that character anymore. Most of it is from Lei's perspective. There are a couple chapters that go back to the Demon King's palace. And or the that main city where they escaped from. And yeah, I don't know what to say. I can't really say a lot because it'll spoil book one and two. And there's a character that I felt really sorry for, like, 'cause she thinks the Demon King loves her, and I'm like, oh honey, no. And this book has a trigger warning in the beginning. Scenes of violence, self-harm, and references to sexual abuse and trauma recovery because the Demon King raped our two main characters. And Lei does abuse alcohol, but she is called out on it and sort of decides to deal with her trauma differently. And that's all I can think of. But yeah, I loved it. I just, when it all went wrong, I was like, well, fuck. Well, fuck. You know? I hate that. And last book I read was Blackfish City. And this was by Natasha Nagan, I believe is how you say the last name. And this is by Sam J. Miller. I gave this 5 stars. Yeah. And it had all the feelings. So this is set in like a dystopian, also but kind of cyberpunky future where there were climate wars. And now people sort of, I don't know if all of the cities are floating, but there's a lot of floating cities. And this one is in the Arctic Circle. So it's pretty cold. And then a woman arrives riding an orca with a polar bear. And they call her the Orcamancer. That's her on the cover. And then she meets with a bunch of other characters. If I can find, I can't remember all their names. There's Kaev, not sure how to say that. K-A-E-V. There's a non-binary character. Sok, S-O-Q. I don't know if I'm pronouncing these correctly. Where's the other character? And Kit are some of our main characters, and they all meet up, and not at first, everybody's separate, but then they all come together and figure out everything and decide to do a little heist of a person. So that's really, because there's a special name for it, but it's almost like a citadel that is slash hospital, but is it really a hospital, where the government puts people who need help, but it's really like for dissidents and stuff. I get that feeling. Maybe there actually is a floor to help people. I'm not 100% sure. But they go there and do a little heist, which is super cool. And then it sort of ends like, not happily, but not like unhappily. Like, things are not great for our group. Things aren't great for the city at the end. But maybe there's a chance to fix it? I don't know. It just sort of ends ambiguously, is the word I'm looking for. There's also a disease going around. What do they call it? The shakes? No, that's not right. You find out about it pretty early on, I think. What is it? I can't remember what it's called, but, so it's kind of like AIDS, but you can get it through sexual transmission, but you can just get it like through other things as well, and it's basically like almost like a cyber disease, because you get it and then you start seeing, not visions, but like one of our characters gets it from a partner, so he'll start seeing other people that person had been with, or where they lived, or stuff like that, and it's just a really weird disease. Nobody knows how it got started, nobody knows basically how you get it, like, besides sex, And there's like not a cure for it, and obviously the government doesn't give a shit because it basically affects poor people. So yeah, I like that part of it as well. Because it does tie into the plot, which is a lot of fun. It's not just like randomly thrown out there. And then one of our characters, not the three I mentioned, he does essentially burn to death in front of people. So there's that. I think that's about maybe halfway through the book. But yeah, I really enjoyed this, and the cover looks great. And I kind of want. I don't think he's going to write a sequel because I believe it's supposed to end like that, but I would love a sequel to know what happens to these characters that I like. So, yeah, those are the books I read in February. Wasn't a lot, but March will hopefully make up for that. Yeah. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. I'm trying to get to 100 subscribers, I think is what my goal was. I can't remember. It's been so long ago. So, you know, if you could like, share, subscribe, that would be great. Thank you for watching the video. I hope you're having a lovely day, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.